and I have interest in it, obvious interest in this in going on. Now, institutional investors are often attacked as passive, lenient, lax on corporate governance issues. However, the regulators, lawmakers, they trust them, they count on the institutional investors to protect the public, to protect the small investors. On one hand, they are inactive. On the other hand, everybody counts on them. So, is this a realistic belief or a wishful belief of naive, perhaps more cynically lazy regulators? And do institutional investors play a positive role in defending small investors? Now, we take a specific deal, an extreme environment, and we find some evidence that they do play a positive role in defending small investors. So we say, yes, sometimes they do. And the deal we talk about are freeze-out tender offers. What are freeze-out tender offers? It's a deal where the control group offers to buy all public shares, take the firm private, okay? And this is a legitimate deal. Okay, there are many legitimate reasons for such a deal. For example, perhaps the control group wants to achieve some synergies with other private company it possesses. Maybe those are typically, our sample is typically small firms. They want to save some regulatory costs. We all know that this regulatory burden is sometimes crushing. Maybe they want to keep information confidential, they don't want to disclose it to the public. Maybe they have some idea, personal vision that they cannot implement with all those public shareholders. Maybe they just want to simplify corporate structure or simply see no value in remaining a public company because they are typically small companies, thinly traded, and perhaps it was a mistake listing, okay? However, there might be some deficient motivation for buying all public shares, okay? Perhaps it's a good timing for buying all public shares, and they want to buy public shares below true value, based on their inside information. This is what we usually call in our field equity tunneling, tunneling via some changes in equity possessions, okay? That is based on asymmetric inside information. So there's also a suspicion that this legitimate deal might consciously or subconsciously be motivated by, let's say, wrong reasons. Now, institutional investors can do something, okay? Why they can do something in favor of the small public investors? Because they are more informed, they are better informed, they can help diminish information asymmetry. They can do some monitoring, say, voice, okay. They tend to suffer less from behavioral bias, meaning we have here among public investors, we have somebody that is more professional and more capable of, say, opposing misconceived ideas of controlling shareholders. And since we deal with a big deal, okay, it's taking the firm private by controlling shareholders, we looked and found in the literature that in big deals, institutional investors do make a difference, okay? Do make a difference. For example, Gasper, Massa, and Matos find that target firms held by institutional investors extract on average a 3% higher premium. So you get a 3% higher premium in M&A deals if you have institutional investors, okay? They perhaps negotiate, perhaps behind the scene, perhaps they have other measures, but you, the end result, you get a higher premium, okay? And then there's another paper also that shows that it has to be concentrated holdings by independent long-term institution, meaning by somebody that has a large holding and cares. And if you have something like that, then post-merger performance is better, is higher. So institutional investors do have an impact on significant firm deals, that's previous evidence. And we think we'll detect such evidence also in our deal, which is a little bit more shady. That controlling shareholders want to take their firm private to buy them from the public. Now, our contribution is that we look at previously unexplored deal in this context of what is the effect of an institutional investor. We think we'll find the effect, a positive effect. We have previously unexplored data. Let me expand a little bit on that. We collect data from Israel, okay, where the regulation of freezeout offers is extremely lax. To make a freezeout offer, you have to issue a 2-3-page document, and you don't have to disclose anything, or almost nothing. You don't have to have board approval. You don't have to have a special committee. You don't have to have a fairness opinion, nothing. You can wake up in the morning and make a freezeout offer, tender offer. And we think we also have interesting, and we don't know if it's unexplored or explored hypothesis, so I put it in a question mark. We think that institutional investors act strategically, and I'll expand on that later on. Now here's the expansion. The three competing hypotheses, not so much competing, but let's see. The null hypothesis says it's institutional investors. That's the null hypothesis. Has no impact whatsoever on the outcome. It's nothing, okay? And we think we can reject it based on previous evidence, on M&As and so on. We think we can reject it, okay? But it's still good to see that we can reject it. Okay, that's a kind of a confirmatory check. Okay, then we have two other hypotheses. The first hypothesis is that institutional investors provide unbiased rational response to each freeze-out offer. They examine each offer separately and decide is it beneficial or not worthwhile, and so on. Okay? And if they do that, they probably filter it out, and accepted offers have higher premia relative to firms where there are no institutional investors at all. And we have about a third of our sample are firms where there are no institutional holdings. So perhaps they filter out the offers and get only offers with decent and high premia. Perhaps they also, because they filter out the offers, they kind of reject a bad offer or exploitive offers, so there will be a higher frequency of offer rejection when institutional investors are there. And our third kind of implication, although we write it in hypothesis C, is when they reject the offer, the offer is not worthwhile, so stock prices will not retreat. Not retreat, will embed the premium. If they reject it, the offer, it means that they think the firm is valued more than the offer. So after the offer, after the rejection of the offer, price will not plunge back. It will stay high. Okay? Will stay high and perhaps go up even more, because if they are rational and if they are good evaluators, the firm is worth more. So it should not plunge and even continue to climb. So that's interesting to examine with the return data. The second alternative hypothesis, which is called hypothesis 3, is that they provide a strategic response to freeze out offers. And what do I mean by strategic response? You have to examine freeze out offers as part of a general picture of struggles, continuous struggles, everyday struggles between, say, institutional investors, outside investors, and controlling shareholders. Okay? It's a power struggle. Okay? And in this power struggle, institutional investor wants to gain some respect, want to get to gain some face, or want to gain some stance. Okay? So what they do is they say no. You need me? I also have some power. I can say no. Okay? In Hebrew we call it dafka. In your face. Okay. So what that means is that still they would accept offer, but only generous offer. Okay? And also there will be higher rate of higher frequency of offer rejection when there are institutional investors involved. And the third implication, which is different from the rational behaviors or concrete examination of every deal, the strategic share says that I'm willing to sacrifice a little bit here for the overall battle gain, okay? Because for my overall interest, and that means that they can reject even fair offers, maybe even slightly beneficial offers. The premium has to be real nice for me to overcome my resentment over you, or my wish to show my power once confronting you. Okay. So this means that after a rejection, a stock price may or may not retreat, or may slightly retreat even. The cumulative excess return from offer announcement, okay, that's one measure we examine, okay? The cumulative excess return from offer announcement to offer rejection or after rejection may or may not exceed on average the offer premium. So we can compare the cumulative excess return from offer announcement to the offer premium. If the cumulative excess return exceeds the offer premium, then the decision to reject is definitely rational and can say it's right. Okay, so now Yevgeny, my dear friend, added a picture here of a small girl looking behind this curtain. So we'll start looking behind the curtain and all those numbers and see if we can find something. This is the slide that shows you how lax is the regulation in Israel regarding tender offers compared to the United States. Okay, those are freeze-out tender offers, okay? Yes, you have to reach 95% of outstanding shares to force the rest of the shareholders to bid their shares to you. But it's more than United States, but you don't need even a discussion board. No board discussion, no board opinion, no special committee, no fairness opinion. Appraisal rights depends. There are some appraisal rights, but we looked and we never found the case of appraisal of in the court. Maybe say behind the scenes. Okay, I don't know. But in the court, we didn't see any fights. Nothing. Disclosure about the company. Nothing. A 2-3-page document that I can wake up in the morning and say, why don't I draft something like that to shareholders? Maybe they'll bite. Okay. What our data set is... Andrew, are you keeping my time? Okay. We identify 274 transactions of Freezeout tender offers and stocks. We exclude stocks with no trading volume because those stocks, what does the premium mean? We exclude non-cash deals. And if offer price is below all recent prices, we exclude also the firm. There are about 30 offers like that, and those are not typical freeze-out offers. Those are probably offers of firms that are collapsing, they need restructuring, and that you are even happy to be offered below market value just to get rid of the thing. Although for the control group, it's better to do the structuring when the firm is private. So we eliminate all those firms. We are left with 201 cases. And just to show you, we tried to collect going private mergers, but there were only 38 of them because this form of freeze-out tender offers is so simple. Everybody, it's a simple venue to go. Okay, about descriptive statistics, the firms are small. $192 million means about $192 million means about $50 million. Those are small companies, and the control group has about 82% of the shares, and the institutional investors have on average 4.3% of the shares. And the premium that they offer is about 20%. We have here also repeated offer, meaning second and third offers after the first one failed. About 15% of the sample are repeated offers, okay. And days from announcement to decision, about 23 calendar days. Acceptance rate, we have here a world record. Only about 50%. The numbers in the United States are close to 80%. I've seen a number from Norway, where is Ola, of 90% acceptance rate. Well, those are the typical numbers, thank you. But here we have 50%, about 50%. 132 offers in firms with institutional holdings, 69 without. It's non-representative of the task. We have no technology firms in the sample, no banks, almost no banks and financial institutions. Those are small firms controlled by controlling shareholders, and I don't know what their thoughts are exactly. Distribution you see of freeze-out of offer premiums, there's one firm with above 150. We do Windsorizing. There are a few firms with below zero, meaning we still keep them because if you calculate relative today minus 42, it's still positive, so we are not sure those are bad offers. Here are offer rejection rates. So there was a a change in the regulation, not in the regulation, there was a change in the United States, some kind of Cox communication ruling that made tender offers more difficult. So offer premium, what we see about offer premium is first, interesting, successful and unsuccessful offers have about the same premium. You cannot judge offer just by premium. Interesting. And the other thing that is more related to our work is that when institutional investors are present, and we are talking about successful offers, why are we talking about successful offers? Because these are offers where money changed hands, not numbers on the wall. Okay, these are offers when actual things happen. Okay, so if you look at that, you see that when the institutional investors are present, the offer premium paid is about 5% more. And if you do it, with a regression, and you introduce firm size, interesting, you see that premium is lower when the firm is higher. In our view, it is because of information asymmetry is higher for smaller firms. So they have to offer, those are successful offers, okay? So if you want to be successful, you have to offer a higher premium. If you are smaller, because there are more information uncertainty, more disbelief, more premium you have to pay to succeed, to convince the public. Okay, but from our point of view, we see a 10% higher premium for when institutional investors are present, and other expected side, okay. Signs, and at the average institutional investor holdings of 4.3% average in our sample, there is an increase of 11.7%. in the premium, most of which is due to the mere presence of institutional investors. When you add the level of holdings of the institutional investor, it has a positive coefficient. It increases the premium, but insignificantly. It's enough that you have any presence by institutional investor and premium, according to our fitted analysis, okay? Premium jumps 10%. So it's a jump the moment you have even one. And then with holdings, it increases, not impressively, but increases. Okay? Now, offer acceptance rate. Here we have a probit analysis, okay? And what you see, firm size, okay, again, larger firms are more trustable and they are more successful in freeze-out offers because people are not that much disbelief, don't have that much disbelief in their motives. There's of course the expected coefficient of control minus holdings because control group holdings, because the higher the control group's holdings, the less distance they have to reach this 95% threshold that guarantees the success of the offer. So if they have less way to go, they are more successful. And if we look at institutional present, again, it's negative, meaning lower chances of success when institutional investors are present. And if you wonder about the relation with the premium, it is positive but insignificant, okay? Like the lower group of premiums have a success rate of about 54, okay, percent, while the higher group of have only, have more than that, about 60%, not impressive very much. So let's go to what I call the Xbox rationality of the rejection decision. And here we see the cumulative of normal returns surrounding failed offers. And you see, even when you reject the offer, okay, maybe you see a little loss of 1 or 2%, but the jump of 20% due to the offer of premium stays with the firm. Okay? So it's not that bad to reject the offer. If you do it correctly, you don't lose the offer premium. Or maybe you lose 1 or 2%. Okay, on average. We use here the net of market model, and here are some numbers comparing institutional investors to no institutional investors. And what we see is first we see that the difference between CAR from announcement date to rejection date, okay? CAR, from announcement date to rejection rate is close to the offer premium, 1.5% on average less, and when no institutional investors are present, only 1% less. So one thing you say, we don't see any effect of having an institutional investor in the firm. And here we measure from announcement date to half a year after the offer rejection. And again, if you look at the averages, it's positive. Okay, maybe it means that after all, the decision was correct and company went up even more than the offer premium. If you look at the medians, it's okay, it's about zero, and no difference between institutional and no institutional investors. Our interpretation. Our first two findings are consisting with both competing hypotheses and biased rational response to each offer. This is the hypothesis two. Explains that institutional investors reject bad offers, extract higher premium, okay. The strategic decision explains institutional investors play tough with controlling shareholders, bad and even fair offers are rejected, only general offer accepted, okay. Okay, then I have to finish. Our third finding appears more consistent with hypothesis three, explains that fair or even slightly beneficial offers rejected. That's why CAR might be slightly negative and not different between institutional and no institutional investors. There is potential criticism, but I'm glad that I don't have time to go over it. The first time I present it, probably criticism can go from now from here to. Summary, main findings, and maybe I'll put this as the last slide. Institutional investors do benefit other investors. Okay, they are important, they do benefit other investors, willingly or unwillingly, I don't care. Okay, overall, the evidence provides some support to the hypothesis that institutional investors are strategic players in a repeated game or conflict with controlling shareholders, okay, I think so. And the puzzle or the question I want to raise now, should institutional investor be allowed to collude on corporate governance issues, okay? Because what we see that the level of institutional holdings have only slight effect. The main effect is having an institutional investor. Having more and more holdings by institutional investors and perhaps more and more institutional investors doesn't have that much of a positive effect. Perhaps because they are not allowed to collude. And here I put a smiley to black. Bernie, you see that smiley? Okay. He wrote in 92, why don't you let institutional investors to collude? Okay. I don't know the answer. Okay. And more tests are usually, that's the comments. Welcome. Okay. Thank you.
It's a very good game. You should raise the
price.
Okay. Andrew, you keep the time.
Andrew has a comment.
Okay, Andrew.
I think there is somehow a disconnect between the motivation and your results, right? Because if you are throwing a big net in the beginning saying we need to know whether institutional investors are good for shareholders and whether they should collude or not, you can't lump some old kind of institutional investors together. There may be some institutional investors whose behavior and information gathering can be useful for shareholders, and there are positive externalities, and there are others that will not. Also, the coalition between institutional investors should matter. So I think what you should be doing, continuing on what Miriam told you, is to open the black box and see what is this group that you call institutional investors, and look inside that group and see the economics of those different type of institutional investors.
Okay. Lucian.
For this idea of your repeated player, there are two ways in which rejecting it can help you in the future. One is that controls in general will give better offers, but also that this controller specifically will come back in half a year or a year and give a better offer. And I know that in the Israeli setting it happens, you might want to.
Yeah, we have 50% of the samples are repeated offers. Repeated meaning second or third offer after the first one fails.
I see. So you might want to look then, in addition to this, right now you're looking at each offer as an observation. But you might want to divide it and say, conditional on the first offer being rejected, what's the likelihood that this company will get a second offer? And conditional on the second offer being rejected, what's the likelihood of the third offer being made? And also each time whether it pays off in terms of getting a higher relationship. The other thing is, for robustness, you might be, found it interesting that you have some companies that don't have any institutional holdings. In the US, each company has some institutional holdings. And you have this variable, which is 1-0.
Yeah.
And the question is whether this is just a proxy for something else. Minus corporates that don't have even a single share of institutional investors. Might they be very small, might they be different in some way, you might want to look into it.
Yeah, I thought the most interesting number you had was that 95, if I read this right, that 95% of the shareholders have to agree.
No, you have to reach 95% holdings in the firm. So if you start from 82%, that's the average pre-offer holdings, that means that about 13 out of 18.
So in other words, 5.1% of the shareholder base can block it.
Yes.
To me, that seems like an extraordinary number. I mean, it's lower in the States. Originally in the States, it was 100%. All shareholders had to agree. That presented obvious problems, and they changed. But to me, that's a very interesting number. And I don't know what the institutional details, but if you look at rights offerings that are in the money, a lot of small retail customers are confused by it and don't participate. I don't know what the laws are in Israel on that. If you just don't respond, are you included or are you excluded? But that 95...
No, you don't bid your shares, then it's against.
Well, in that case, the 95% is even more amazing, because you're going to have some people in the hospitals, you're going to have confused widows and orphans and what have you. I mean, that's an extraordinary number. So I think the thing that's interesting is to compare that number of 95% to what the number is elsewhere in the world. And I think you probably find some startling differences between these freeze-outs in Israel and elsewhere.
I think it's 90% in many countries in Europe, it's all 90%.
Yeah, but I think there's a huge difference, at least to me, and I was never that good at math, between 90 and 95%. I mean, you know, it's a whole lot.
I was just 55.
But I mean, to me, that's very interesting. I mean, if that's true, Israel's an outlier. And an outlier can make an interesting paper. But it's a different paper. That's the next paper.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for throwing my verdict.
So I don't see anything.
So what do you say?
Should
collude
that would let or shed any light on hypotheses. Right?
Again.
I don't see anything in the paper that will shed any light on hypothesis three.
Okay.
Strategic behavior.
Yeah.
And I actually don't see any way that you can get there with your data. Okay. Right? Investors may well have different reservation prices for different firms. We know this. We don't observe the reservation prices, right? It's interesting that you don't see higher premia in the accepted deals and the rejected deals, but we don't have any visibility into why. And I was trying to think about how could you test the strategic behavior possibility.
I think if you do it sequentially, you get it. Before.
Yeah, over time, but you don't have enough deals in Israel to do this. You're never going to get any statistical power.
How many financial institutions do you have?
I think there are about 15, maybe
15. So
between 15 to 20.
You can see the variation between those that have rejected and those that haven't rejected.
I think the following pattern, pattern will support the very strategic behavior. If you find that when they reject the first offer, then either they get a higher offer later on, and if they never get a higher offer, then it declines. This means that they didn't, when they rejected the first offer, not so much because they thought that the long-term value would go, but because they were bargaining hard.
That's the way of
how to get a higher offer the second or the third time. If they bluffed, they were too tough, and they didn't get a higher offer, then. So basically, that pattern would be consistent with.
Okay, thank you. In my hat as a the conference organizer, I have to step down. And what do we have now in the forum? A break, okay.
Thank you, Benny, for giving me the opportunity to discuss this paper. I enjoyed reading it. I will start by first summarizing the paper. So this study explores the role of institutional investors with respect to tender offers made by controlling shareholders. They're called freeze-out tender offers. What the authors find is that, I'm going to start by just summarizing first the main findings and then obviously discussing. So just to kind of give you an overview of the paper, approximately half of the freeze-out offers are rejected, and as Benny noted, that's a relatively high rejection rate. The premium of accepted freeze-out offers is larger when institutional investors are present. So conditional on an offer being accepted, the premium is going to be higher if there are institutional investors present. The mean cumulative excess return of stocks with rejected offers from the offer announcement to half a year later is actually slightly higher when institutional investors do not hold the stock. And so the interpretation of the authors, as Benny alluded, is that institutional investors reject more offers than they actually should reject. Why do they do this? Because it's a repeated game. They hope that if they reject an offer today, in the future, they're going to get a higher premium. And that's why they reject more offers than they really need to reject. So that's just a short summary of the paper. And now I'm going to give some comments. And my goal in this discussion, because Benny told me that this is the first version, my goal in this discussion is really to give constructive comments, which I hope will just allow to improve, to be helpful for the authors. So the first thing I want to talk about is the research design. The paper essentially contrasts companies that have institutional ownership to companies that do not have institutional ownership. And it's very, we can't be sure that these are really similar companies. There may be some indigeneity here, which is that institutional investors may choose to invest in certain kind of companies, whereas non-institutional investors may choose to invest in other types of companies. So what I want to try to encourage the authors to do is to really try to make more use of variation within within institutional ownership. And what I mean by that is that I like the measure with Kempf, Mancani, and Spalt, and I probably did not pronounce their name correctly, but they have a nice measure in their paper, which what they do is they essentially look at the portfolio of institutional investors. And they say, let's see which institutional investors are distracted in a given quarter. What do they mean by distracted? They say, well, if an institutional investor has a high fraction in an industry that now has a large shock, it could be either positive or negative, that institutional investor is going to be distracted. And so what I would like to propose is that let's see how companies that have a distracted institutional investor versus a non-distracted institutional investors respond this differently to tender freeze-out offers. If we really see a difference there, then it really is more convincing that it's really the institutional investors which make a difference, as opposed to other unobservable factors that could differ between companies that have an institutional investor versus companies which don't have an institutional investor. So what I'm going to talk now is I'm going to suggest some additional research questions which maybe you want to look at, but also incorporate this measure into the existing research question and suggest how you can incorporate this measure. First thing, I think it would just be helpful a little bit to give the reader a sense of what percentage of the listed or disappearing companies experienced the freeze-out. We know that both in the U.S., there have been papers that have documented that both in the U.S., and we also know that in Israel, more and more companies are disappearing. Curley and Stoltz, they have a paper, and I forgot the third co-author, that shows that this is the case in the U.S. And I just saw an article in the Israeli newspaper which said that 60 companies disappeared from the Israeli stock exchange. So I think, first of all, to convince the reader that freeze-outs are something interesting and important, I think it just would be helpful to tell the reader what percentage of disappearing companies disappear because of a freeze-out tender offer. The other thing, and this is kind of a little bit inspired by the hedge fund papers, ask a basic questions, and that is, which type of companies are targeted by hedge funds? And I think it would be nice to ask a similar question in the context of freeze-out companies, which is, which type of companies are targeted by a freeze-out company? Why do I think it's interesting? First of all, in a sense, it's opposite to the papers that investigate why firms go public. It actually tells us which companies have a high cost of going public, and therefore the owners want to take the company back. So I think that would be something, again, interesting. It's not the main thing, but would give us a sense of why these freeze-outs are interesting, why they happen, and what the costs of being public are. The next thing, again, this is a graph from Alon Brav, and I put this before I knew he was going to be at the conference. It's from his paper about hedge funds. And what they show in that paper is that before filing of an activist happens, activists quietly acquire their shares in a company. I think maybe you could find something here, again, just to give a more rich picture of what's happening in the context of freeze-out. Do they do something quietly before the freeze-out offer, and does that also later on affect the likelihood that the freeze-out offer will succeed? Now, going back to what I was talking before about the Kempf, let's just call it KMS measure of distracted institutional investors, I want to incorporate that now back to the research questions. So I mentioned before that I think it would be helpful if we could give the reader a little bit more convincing evidence that what is really going on is really due to the presence of institutional investors as opposed to other endogenous factors in the company. And so, for example, using this measure, I would now ask, do shareholders time freeze-out offers when institutionals are distracted? Because if institutionals are a barrier to freeze-out offers being accepted, maybe if you have institutionals that are distracted, you're more likely to see that freeze-out offers are going to be accepted. Then I would do the same existing questions, but with the institutional distracted investor element. So for example, is the freeze-out more likely to succeed if investors are distracted? Is the premium lower if investors are distracted? Is performance of rejected institutional freeze-out lower if they are distracted, and so on? The last comment is, your main story is that they reject offers because it's a repeated game. So I think it would be helpful to see whether institutionals that have recently rejected offers really get higher premiums in the next freeze-out offers. Because if I'm an institutional and I have a reputation of being very tough with accepting freeze-out offers, then you should see that I am getting higher premiums, at least if my strategy worked out as you proposed that it that it is. One thing which I say this because of the paper that Mike and I had together on the Israeli boards, one of the questions we would always get on that paper is, why are you examining Israeli data? Why can't you do this paper with US data? And I think any paper that looks at non-American data has to somehow justify why there's a good reason to look at this data, not in the US. So I put here some ideas. I think maybe you can even do better. I tried my best here, but I think it is important to say, look, we have a good reason why we're looking at Israeli data. So one thing which I thought is, first of all, you don't need board approval. Why is that, I think, an advantage? It's because it allows you to disentangle the effect of board, which does not exist in your setting, from shareholders in the context of freeze-out offers. So I think that's an advantage. The other thing, which you can argue, is that shareholder structure in Israel resembles that of many non-American countries. So if you have a question about how a large shareholder affects freeze-outs, then it makes sense to examine this question in a place where you actually have frequently large shareholders, and that is not so frequent in the U.S. Maybe the Israeli setting offers some unique data. Maybe you can find something. Perhaps you can observe a change following the pyramid legislation change. I don't even know what the right name in English is, but there was this legislation change. Maybe that can be an exogenous shock, again, which can allow you to find some interesting variation around that change. I found some interesting relevant papers which are squarely about freeze-outs and shareholder wealth. They're not cited in the paper, and I thought you probably want to cite those. They have citations. They're in good journals, especially the first two ones and maybe also the other ones down here. So I put them here. I think they'll be helpful. Some minor comments. I'm not going to talk about all of them because I have limited time, but I was wondering, for example, why there's a dip there that kind of goes against your story. And you know, a graph is the main important thing to convey the message. So I was wondering why there's a dip there. The other thing I was wondering, I don't have that graph here, but you showed how the CAR increases when offers are rejected. Someone could tell here an opposite story, which is the reason there's such a high CAR is that now investors learn that there's like a signal. They now know the company is worth more than they originally thought, because if shareholders want to buy it back, maybe they know more than we, the little investors, know. So potentially that's just the reason of why there's such a high large CAR. And that is it. Thank you so much. Thank you.